Now the microwave bipolar transistor, so at high frequency ranges we are going to employ our bipolar transistor, and this technology has been advanced significantly during the past 3 decades, and the principle of operation is similar to that of low frequency device. So all the basic principle which we have learned in the bipolar transistor, they are the same when we are considering the microwave transistors also. But the requirements of dimension, process control, heat sinking, packaging, all these at high frequency, they are going to be much more severe. And silicon bipolar transistor, they dominate for frequency range from UHF to about S band, that is about 3 gigahertz. As the technology has progressed, the upper frequency limit has gone up to 22 gigahertz. Okay, so the majority of the bipolar transistors of the current interest, they are fabricated from silicon. So till now, the majority of our microwave transistor, they are made still from silicon. Even though gallium arsenide devices, they are going to offer prospects for improvements in operating frequency, high temperature, radiation hardness. Even though gallium arsenide device is better, silicon, because of its other types of advantages in ease of fabrications, etc., majority still we are employing the silicon bipolar transistors. So here are some merits of the silicon bipolar transistor. You can go through all this. Silicon bipolar transistor, why are they being chosen? Okay, so the characteristics which makes silicon to be chosen for our microwave transistor is given. You can go through all these points. So when we are speaking about the structure of our transistor, microwave transistor, we usually prefer a NPN structure since the electron mobility is higher than the hole mobility. So you can take note of it. And usually the operating frequency is up to 5 gigahertz. So here we consider a planar silicon NPN transistor. So here this is a cross-sectional view and the figure B shows a top view. So usually how is the transistor structure? We will be having a emitter, base and collector. So similarly here also we are having, say, first a n-type silicon substrate, and above this we are having a epitaxial layer, n-epitaxial layer, which is acting as a collector, and above it we are having a p-type diffused base, and above that we are having a heavily doped n-diffused layer which act like a emitter. So it is a normal structure, that is an emitter here, base here and the collector here. So emitter, base and collector. And other thing to be noted here is that emitter and base contacts are generally located on the semiconductor surface planar arrangement. That is, emitter and base is only coming in contact with the surface. So that is what is shown here in the top view. Okay, so this is a general planar arrangement of our silicon NPN microwave transistor, and this is a top view of it. So the type of surface geometry, that is, we are having a 3 types of surface geometry, that is interdigitated, overlay and matrix. Okay, the matrix can also be called as a mesh or emitter grid. And the interdigitated type of structure, they are used for a small signal and power, whereas overlay and matrix type, they are used for small power only. So we will see each of these surface geometry now one by one. Now when we are coming to the different types of geometry, remember that our emitter and the base, okay, is having contact with the surface. And here in both of the geometries, in the interdigitated and the overlay, the emitter and the base which is coming in contact with the surface, they are being metallized. Okay, so first geometry, that is an interdigitated geometry. Kindly observe the interdigitated geometry. It is a finger-like structure. That is, the emitter and the base, they both are of a finger-like structure. So it is like the crossing of the fingers of the emitters and the base. Suppose we are having a n plus 1 base fingers, where n is the number of emitter fingers. So if n is the number of emitter fingers here, so this is a emitter fingers, then we will be having here n plus 1 base fingers. So it is a finger like structure, that is the emitter and the base fingers are being crossed. Okay, so such a type is geometry is a interdigitated geometry. So large number of emitter stripes alternating with base stripes, and as the number of the finger is going to increase, the output power capability is also going to increase. Okay, so how our application is, if we require more power, we require more number of fingers, so the output power capability of the transistor increases. But however, if we are having more additional finger, it may increase the device parasitics and degrade the noise and upper frequency capability of the device. So it can be a disadvantage also if you are going to increase the number of fingers. So this is an interdigitated geometry. Next we are having an overlay geometry. So here also the emitter and base are being metallized. Here the difference is we are having segmented type of emitters. So you can see these emitters are segmented and they are being overlaid to the metal stripes. Okay, so the overlay geometry has a large number of segmented emitters. So these are the segmented emitters and they are being overlaid through a wide number of wide metal stripes. Okay, so this is a overlay geometry. That is, what is being overlaid into the metal stripes? The emitters, those emitters, segmented emitters, they are only being overlaid. Now here again in the matrix or the mesh geometry, we are having coming in contact with the surface emitter and base, and they are both are being metallized. Emitter metallization and base metallization. The structure actually looks similar to that of the interdigitated, where we are having finger-like structure for the emitter and the base. But here, what is addition to this matrix or mesh is that it looked like a mesh geometry. That is, in the middle of the mesh, we are going to add a diffused region of a base. That is, we are going to add a P plus base region by diffusing it into the mesh. So that is the difference here. Okay, so the matrix or the mesh geometry has emitter that forms the grid. The base is going to fill the meshes of this grid with the P plus contact area in the middle of each mesh. So in the middle of this mesh, we are always going to diffuse a P region base. Okay, that is the matrix geometry. Now here this slide shows a figure of merit expression for each of these various surface geometry. So each of the surface geometry and a unit cell is being considered, and when we are writing the equation for the figure of merit, each expression is different. Okay, so just to understand these about the figure of merit expression, here L is representing the length here of this finger-like structure of the electrode which is used, and W is the width of the electrode, and here S represents the spacing or the separation between each of the electrodes used, and P is the pitch or the mismatch distance between the electrodes which are used. Okay, so just go through this slide, that is, understand that there is a figure of merit which is going to differ for each of these various surface geometry. So this is the expression for overlay, this is the expression for interdigitated, and this is the expression for the matrix geometry. Now the operation for a microwave transistor. Okay, so whether it be NPN or PNP, we will be able to explain the working of a microwave transistor since we already know the basics. That is, there will be obviously emitter base collector region. And what happens, initially we consider these are reverse biased, and when we are going to apply our microwave input signal, the emitter and the base junction, they are going to become forward biased. So here I have written the working for PNP transistor. You can write the working for NPN also. NPN is the one which we commonly consider. So considering a PNP transistor, what happens, from the emitter, the carriers, that is the holes, are going to come, they are going to diffuse, and they will be drifting through the thin base region. We know the doping of the base region, it will be thin when we are comparing it with the emitter region. So the thin base region, it will be drifting through the base region, and it will be collected by the collector, and it will be accelerated to the negative terminal of bias voltage between the collector and base terminal. That is, usually the emitter base junction is forward biased and the collector base junction is reverse biased. And then what happens, a pulse of current will flow through the load connected in the collector circuit. Similarly, we can write for a NPN transistor also. So, the transistor configuration for our microwave bipolar transistor is also same as that of the ordinary transistor. That is, it can be connected in three configuration: common base, common emitter and common collector. So, depending upon the polarity of the bias voltage connected to its terminals. So, the configurations of microwave transistor is same as what we have learned from the our ordinary transistor. So, here is a representation shown in case of a NPN transistor for a common base configuration, for a common emitter configuration and for a common collector configuration. Okay, and we have written these functions, that is VEB and IC, and for a common collector configuration we are going to take the output voltage of the load is taken from the emitter terminal. Okay, so just refresh through all these figures. We have already learned about common base, common emitter and common collector configurations. Just go through these figures and understand that it is same for the low frequency and high frequency. The modes of operation also in case of microwave transistor, it is same as that of we have already studied, that is normal mode, saturation mode, cutoff mode and inverse mode. The modes in the case of a transistor, the microwave transistor, is same as that of the usual modes in transistor. That is, a normal mode will be the emitter junction forward bias and the collector base junction reverse bias. So that is what you call as a normal mode. Forward bias means positive polarity is connected to P side and negative polarity is connected to N side in case of PN junction. So reverse bias means just the vice versa. Okay, so the transistors, when they are operated in the normal mode, mainly for amplification purpose. Okay, so the common base current gain alpha can be denoted, for example, like alpha n. Okay, and what will be the saturation mode? Saturation mode means both the junction, that is the emitter base and the collector base, both of the junctions, they may be forward biased. Okay, so that is the saturation mode. So in saturation mode, it will be having a very low resistance and act like a short circuit. Whereas in cutoff mode, both of the junctions are reverse biased and it act like a cutoff mode. And as the current is cut off, the transistor is going to act like a open circuit. So both in the cutoff mode and saturation mode, the transistor will act like a switching device. So for employing it as a switch, transistor works between the cutoff mode and the saturation mode. Now what will be the inverse mode? The inverse mode is when the emitter base junction is reverse biased and the collector base junction is forward biased. So it is operated in the inverted mode. Okay, so in such cases the current gain is designated say as inverse of alpha, and if the transistor is a symmetric transistor, then this alpha n is equal to alpha I. That is, the current gain in the normal mode will be equal to the current gain in the inverse mode. Okay, but in actual or in practical, the current gains cannot be equal because of the unequal dopings. So concerning the modes of operation, inverse mode, as you can see, the emitter base junction reverse biased and the collector base junction is forward biased. And in the cutoff mode, you can see both of them, that is the emitter base junction as well as the collector base junction. We can see both of them are reverse biased. Okay, and in the saturation mode, you can see both the emitter base junction and the collector base junction, both are being forward biased. Okay, forward bias, we know P is connected to positive and N is connected to negative terminal. And in normal mode, the emitter base junction will be forward biased and the collector base junction, it will be reverse biased. Now the discussion is about the power frequency limitation of a microwave transistor. So several studies had been conducted regarding the microwave transistor and some assumptions was made by Johnson, and based on these assumptions only, Johnson derived four basic equations for power frequency limitations on microwave power transistor. So these are the three assumptions. First assumption is that there is a maximum possible velocity of carriers in a semiconductor. So this maximum velocity by which the carriers can drift in a semiconductor, that is called as a saturated drift velocity VS, and its value is of the order 6×10⁶ centimeter per second for electrons and holes in silicon and germanium. So this is the first assumption, that is about the maximum saturated drift velocity. Okay, and second assumption is that there is a maximum electric field EM which can be sustained in a semiconductor without having dielectric breakdown. And the value of this maximum electric field, it is of the order 10⁵ volt per centimeter in germanium and 2×10⁵ volt per centimeter in silicon. The third assumption is the maximum current that a microwave power transistor can carry is limited by the base width. Okay, so the base width will decide upon the maximum current that a microwave power transistor can carry. So based on these three assumptions only, the four basic equations of the power frequency limitation on microwave power transistors was made. Now coming to the first equation, that is a voltage frequency limitation, we have to remember this equation Vm×Ft is equal to EmVs divided by 2 pi, whose value is 2×10⁻¹ volt per second for silicon and 1×10⁻¹ volt per second for germanium. So how we can write this equation? Okay, if Vm is the maximum allowable applied voltage, we can write voltage to be equal to electric field into distance. So Vm we can write it as Em×L. Okay, where Em is a maximum electric field and L is the distance between the collector and emitter. Okay, and we can write the charge carrier transit time cutoff frequency, that is Ft, to be 1 pi 2 pi × time period. So here the time period is represented as tau, that is the average time taken for the carrier to move from the emitter to collector at a distance of L. So Ft is 1 by 2 pi tau, and tau can be represented as distance by velocity. So here we have to consider the distance between the emitter to collector, that is at a distance of L. So instead of Ft, we can now write it as 1 by 2 pi tau, we can represent it as L by V. So we get Ft is equal to V divided by 2 pi × L. Okay, so again coming back to Vm is equal to Em×L. So for L we can substitute from the Ft equation, then we get Vm is equal to Em×Vs divided by 2 pi Ft, and finally Vm×Ft is equal to Em×Vs by 2 pi. Now here Vs is the maximum saturated drift velocity for the carrier. Okay, so this is how we have written the first equation, that is a voltage frequency limitation. Now we have seen the first equation. Now with the carriers moving at a saturated velocity of 6×10⁶ centimeter per second, the transit time can be reduced by decreasing our emitter collector distance L. So the lower limit on this distance L can be reached when the electric field becomes equal to the dielectric breakdown field. But practically we choose the value of L as such, that is a 25 micrometer for overlay and matrix devices and 250 micrometer for our interdigitated devices. And also we have written the expression about the upper cutoff frequency, that is there is a limit, upper limit on the cutoff frequency also. In practice, the attainable cutoff frequency is considerably less than the maximum possible frequency which is indicated by the equation, because our saturated drift velocity Vs and the electric field intensity, it will not be uniform. Now this is a second equation, that is regarding the current and frequency limitation. So in the previous equation we have written what Vm×Ft is equal to Em×Vs by 2 pi. So instead of that Vm, that is a maximum allowable applied voltage, we can write voltage value as current into resistance. So that is current, maximum current Vm is equal to Im×Xc we have written. So instead of resistance we have written here the reactive impedance. So that substitution is made in the first equation, and then we got the second equation, that is a current frequency limitation. And here Im is the maximum current and Xc is the reactive impedance, that is a 1 by 2 pi Ft into C naught, where C naught is the collector to base capacitance. Okay, and from this, if the impedance level is going to be zero, then the maximum current can flow through a velocity saturated sample. It might be infinite. However, there is a limited impedance which will limit a maximum current for a maximum attainable power. Now coming to the power frequency limitation, third equation, it is given by the product of voltage frequency and current frequency limitation. So we have got the equation for the first two limitation, that is voltage frequency and current frequency. So now we can multiply Vm Ft into Im Ft, and Vm Im we can replace it by Pm, since power is given by the multiplication of voltage and the current. So Pm Ft square. So when we are doing the multiplication, we know the first value, that is the Vm Ft, is Em Vs by 2 pi, and second Im into Ft can be written as Em Vs by 2 pi Xc. Okay, so this is going to give our third equation. So we can write Pm Xc the whole raised to half into Ft is equal to Em Vs divided by 2 pi. This is the equation of power frequency limitation. For a given device impedance, the power capacity of the transistor, it is going to decrease with increase in the cutoff frequency. Now the fourth equation, that is the power gain frequency limitation. Okay, this is given by the equation Gm Vth Vm the whole raised to half into F is equal to Em Vs by 2 pi, where Gm, it is a maximum available power gain. Vth is equal to Kt by E is the thermal voltage. K is a Boltzmann constant whose value is given. Capital T is the absolute temperatures in degrees Kelvin. And E is the electron charge, that is 1.60 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb. Now in the above equation, there is a term Gm, that is a maximum available power gain of the transistor. Now that term, it was actually derived by Johnson in relation to the transit time cutoff frequency and in relation to the impedance in the transistor, that is Ft by F the whole squared into Z out by Zin. So actually Johnson, by his study, he had initially derived this power gain equation for a transistor Gm as such, relating the frequencies and the impedance. Now if we are considering the electrode series resistance to be zero, that is we consider only these capacitances, okay, this junction capacitance of the transistor, then we can represent the output impedance to the input impedance as Cin divided by Cout. So this is our sixth equation, where Cin is the input capacitance and Cout is the output capacitance, which means a base to collector capacitance. Okay, now how can we write the Cin and Cout? We know that C can be written as Q by V, or Q is equal to C into V. So we assume that a total charge carriers of say Qm is moving to the collector in a carrier based transit time of say tau B with the thermal voltage of Vth. Then the input capacitance and the emitter diffusion capacitance Cd can be related by this equation. So we know that C can be represented as Q by V. Here Q is the total charge carriers, which is finally moving to the collector side. And Vth is the thermal voltage which is existing. So C in and Cd, they can be represented as Qm by Vth. Okay, we can further modify this term Qm, that is the total charge carriers Qm, as the multiplication of the current which is existing into the time taken, that is Q is equal to I into T, that is Im into, here time will be the transit time which the carriers take to move, that is a carrier based transit time is tau B. So the input or the diffusion capacitance, while the charge carriers are moving to the collector with respect to the carrier based transit time tau B, it can be expressed as what? Im tau B divided by Vth. Okay. Similarly, you can write the equation for output capacitance as Im tau naught divided by Vm. Okay, so in the fourth equation, that is our limitation of the transistor, that is the fourth equation, He Johnson, he had originally derived the equation for the maximum available power gain of the transistor as such, where you could represent the term of Z out by Z in terms of the input and the output capacitance. And these are the relations for the input and the output capacitance. Now, all these equations, actually the performance of the microwave transistor is not going to hold in hand with the equation which we have stated. The actual performance will be less. That is, in the fourth equation, we have stated about the power gain frequency limitation. But the actual performance, it will be far below it. At present, the high frequency limit of a 28-volt silicon NPN transistor operating at the 1 watt level is approximately only 10 gigahertz. Okay. So, the typical power gains of the microwave transistors will be lying in the ranges of 6 to 10 dB range. So, understand these operating ranges of the microwave transistor. Now, here I have shown a problem which has been asked for the examination. This problem is from the Liavo textbook. So, a certain silicon microwave transistor has got the following parameters. So, certain parameters are given and it is asked to determine the maximum allowable power that a transistor can carry. So, it is the third equation which we have studied regarding the power frequency limitation of a microwave transistor. So, when you are substituting all these parameter values in this expression, you will get the answer. So, in this section, we have discussed about microwave transistor, and in this, the most important things are the physical structure. Okay, the configurations of the geometrical features of our microwave transistor, then about the power frequency limitation equations of the transistor. Okay, so these are the most important things in this particular section.